Okay, can everybody hear me? Okay, good. Okay, we have a green, so let's go ahead and get started. Again, I want to thank everybody that came out 9 o'clock this morning to go ahead and see this. Hopefully I won't go ahead and disappoint you, but I am going to warn you right now that maybe I will, because after you leave this presentation, you will say, Brad didn't tell me anything I didn't already know. So, you know, if at the end you say, what did he tell me new? Nothing. I will have done my job. Pretty much so. But before we get started, I would like to go ahead and thank the selfless volunteers that go ahead and put together SELF. This is my second time attending. I will become a regular here. This is an absolutely fantastic group, and there are a lot of hardworking people that go ahead and behind the scenes to put this together. I will admit, this is the first time I've given a presentation, had somebody come in and say, we're here to set you up, and they're holding a rifle case. It doesn't hurt that I've just been binging Breaking Bad, so I wanted to duck under the table. Oh, okay. So we're going to talk about Gary Larson today and how he went ahead and helped me realize how to build infinitely scalable high-performance systems. So, my name is Brad Whitehead, and now you're saying, okay, so what are your qualifications? Why are you here talking to me? What do you know? So, I used to be a partner with Accenture and one of their master technology architects, which means we were the small group that really went ahead and did the hardcore technical architecture behind large systems. And when I say large systems, I'm talking about national level systems. I personally worked on, I was the chief architect for U.S. Visit. That is the system that drives customs and border patrols, border entry. When you come in and you give them your fingerprints, that's my system that goes ahead and compares you against everything in the FBI database, everything in the watch database, and certain intelligence agencies' databases. Additionally, TWIC, the Transportation Workers Identification Card System. Is anybody here familiar with TWIC? Crickets. Okay, that's fine. Nobody here then is obviously working at the docks or transporting hazardous chemicals like gasoline or propane or anything like that. If you do, you have to be vetted by the Department of Homeland Security and issued a TWIC card. So there are about 3 million people out there that we've gone ahead and vetted, and we have all their biometrics on file. The third system that I worked on that you all probably are familiar with is TSA PreCheck. So again, I was the architect on Accenture's side for the development of PreCheck. So those three systems all have something in common. They're what we call guns and badges systems. They are involved with law enforcement, and they tell you what you can and you can't do based on your biometrics. It's fulfilling work, but the thing that was really fulfilling was when I went ahead and worked on the Republic of India's Aadhaar program. Now again, does anybody here know what Aadhaar is? Okay, so India is the second most populous country in the world. First? Okay. 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 The last time I looked, they were at 1.1 billion. I'm not sure where they are now. But what we did was we went, what's that? China's dropping because of their birth rate? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So what we did or okay, I'm sorry, 1.1 billion people, 80% of those people fall into what they call the poverty line in India. And being below the poverty line means that they get government benefits. Same type benefits that we go ahead and give people, such as food stamps, reduced costs of cooking gas, reduced costs of petrol, things like that, as well as guaranteed work. But the big problem is that of those 80% of the country, the 80% of the 1.1 billion, not only are they in poverty, but they really don't officially exist. There are no records that go ahead and say they are who they are. Each one of the states and each one of the villages goes ahead and keeps track of birth records and whatnot like that, but there wasn't anything at the national level. So you couldn't open a bank account. You can't meet India's Know Your Customer regulations for opening a bank account. There are any number of things that you can't do. You can't even own a cell phone over there unless you can go ahead and prove you are who you say you are. So the government looked at this and said, there's got to be something we can go ahead and do. A large society like this, having to pay people in cash, there's a lot of corruption that goes on. So they wanted to go ahead and end that. And there's some very, very smart people in India with Infosys and some of the other companies that have come over here to the United States as consulting companies. And what they did was they said, okay, we're going to go ahead and we're going to take the biometrics of everybody, 10 fingers, 2 irises. We're going to go ahead and assign them a random number, 12-digit random number. That's your Aadhaar number. And then any time you go ahead and you get your rations, you go to the rice merchant and you go ahead and get a couple kilos of rice for free, you'll go ahead and give your biometrics. At that point then, they will register that that merchant did fulfill his requirement to give you 2 kilos of rice for free. As opposed to what he used to do, which was go ahead and tell you that, get out of my store, he would then go ahead and give the 2 kilos of rice to his friend and report back to the government, I gave 2 kilos of rice to the person that he kicked out of the store. Same thing, there's guaranteed work there. I don't care what your status is, if you want a job, there's a job available for you. It might even be something just like sweeping the highways, but it's available. And what happens is at the end of your shift, you get paid. You used to get paid in cash. Yeah, right. So, little old lady, I'm not picking on little old ladies, but little old lady's been brushing the highway all day. She's supposed to get 5 rupee. Supervisor gives her 1 rupee and says, the other 4 is a service charge. Nobody knows the difference. Okay, now the little old lady has a bank account, and the deposit's directly in the bank account from the government. So they've cut out the corruption there. Now, what this doesn't do is that they don't keep track of where you are. Your biometrics don't say that you are an Indian citizen. Anybody can get an Aadhaar card. I tried to get one time. We were having a conference much like this, and we were enrolling people, and I was going to go ahead and get enrolled, and the only problem was I didn't have a address for more than 90 days because I was staying out of a hotel at the particular time. But anybody can go ahead and get this. Pakistanis can go ahead and get it in India. It doesn't say you're an Indian citizen. It doesn't say whether you can travel. It doesn't have any of the things that we normally associate with government-issued identification. So Aadhaar is a tremendous program, not only from the standpoint of what it went ahead and did for the people of India. Oh, should have advanced the slide. So that is the Aadhaar system. Okay, we were enrolling 1 million people a day. First day, no problem. 1 million biometrics, 10 fingers, 2 irises, did it before lunch type of a thing. Last day, you have to take the 1 million for that day and you have to compare it against the 1.1 billion that are already in the database to be sure that nobody's accidentally or on purpose double registered. So this will give you some idea of what it was. 1 trillion comparisons, or I'm sorry, 1 quadrillion comparisons, and that's about 11 billion transactions per second. Okay, again, India was very smart in how they selected their biometric service providers. There were three of us, and we were competing against each other, and whoever could go ahead and do the most got the lion's share of the next quarter's worth of enrollments, and we got paid for each enrollment. Okay, so our other two companies were very strong in biometrics. They had proprietary systems, proprietary hardware. A million a day, even on the last day, was really no problem for them. We weren't more than 6 months into it, and we were at about 500,000 transactions per day, and we topped out. So we were at the point of that point having to go ahead and tell the government, India, thank you very much for letting us play, but we're going to have to go home. We were using a very popular piece of biometric middleware, and it used the Oracle database for all of its workflow. Basically, we maxed out the transaction rate on the Oracle database. We were using real application clusters, which before Oracle Cloud was the way that they said, you go ahead. I see a couple of faces out there in the audience. You've already worked with real application clusters, RAC. So we had four of the largest servers that we could go ahead and put together running RAC, and we had topped out. And when I say we, it wasn't just Accenture, it was also Oracle. Oracle Redwood and Oracle Bangalore, they tuned the systems as best they could. We couldn't break 500,000 enrollments per day. So that's when I got called in. My role has always been sort of a firefighter. And I took a look at it. And we went ahead and we went with a different system. And this is the system that I'm going to go ahead and tell you about today. And it's not going to cost you anything. Okay, RAC. Oracle doesn't allow customers to publish benchmarks. It's right there in the license saying you can't publish benchmarks. But there are a few customers, based on their clout and their size, that are willing to go ahead and do that to some degree. And as you can see, one particular customer realized that RAC, no matter, you know, if everything were ideal, it would be infinitely scalable, but really it's about five servers before it hits the limit. So here's the typical scaling diagram. You either scale vertically, which is what we tried, make it the biggest server you possibly can, and when you can't do that, then you go ahead and you scale horizontally, which means you add more servers working together. That's what RAC was. Why didn't it work? Shared resources. The database, all those servers were working together. They had shared state, they had shared resources. Okay, whenever you've got shared resources, you have to be polite about it. You can't both go ahead and use the resource at the same time. So you might go ahead and put a lock in place and say, okay, I'm going to lock the resource, I'm going to use it, I'm going to unlock it. God forbid that I die while it's locked, because that's going to go ahead and cause problems. Or if I don't lock it, we're going to do what we call a race condition. I'm going to change it, you're going to change it, I'm going to read it, and it's not what I wrote. Any number of problems, and we've come up with all sorts of solutions, locks, mutexes, semaphores, latches, monitors. This is an example of two threads that are going ahead and trying to use a common resource, and they're using a monitor. Okay, simple, right? Nothing could go wrong in that type of a transaction scenario. Not only that, but we've got the word wait right here, and we've got suspend in there somewhere. I don't see where it is right now, but oh yeah, here we go. Suspend thread. Ooh, my battery's going. Uh-oh. Okay. Again, on a high-performance system, you don't want to wait. You don't want to suspend things. So this is what RAC ran into. This is why RAC went ahead and failed. Okay. It's a AAA. Okay, well, let's go on. Okay. So I put together a system over in India using Mr. Larson as my tutor. There are four components to it, the secret sauce. Okay. Mr. Larson, in fact, doesn't come in until part number three. but you need to understand part number one and part number two before we get to part number three. Okay, so the secret solution is actors, cues, pull, don't push, and unikernels. Let's get started with actors, and this is an Aykroyd, Murray, and Ramis. We're talking about the actor model that Carl Hewitt developed back in 1973. Basically, he went ahead and took a look at it and said, if we went ahead and created something that was self-contained and communicated with other self-contained processes via messages, we wouldn't have shared resources. We wouldn't have shared resources, and we wouldn't need the locking type situations that we've got. So he developed the idea of actors. Okay, an actor is a process, self-contained. It makes local decisions based on its input. It can, fantastic, thank you very much. Okay, it can create new actors, can replicate itself. It can send out messages to other actors. It can adjust its own internal state. It doesn't share that state with anybody else. It's sort of opaque, but it can go ahead and change its own internal state. And then the one thing that Carl said that I disagree with was the communications through mailboxes. So you get a message in, it goes into the mailbox, you can have any number of messages queue up, you won't lose anything, and then the actor goes ahead and pulls each request off the mailbox. But like I say, we went ahead and we modified that slightly in the Indian situation. Okay, the actor model, if anybody here is familiar with the programming language Erlang, it is built, I see somebody else, it is built on the actor model. In fact, the developer of the Erlang programming language was working for Ericsson at the time, and they used that in one of their telephone switches. It has a reliability of 9 nines. 99.7 more nines. That is 31 milliseconds of downtime per year. Has anybody ever managed a tier 4 data center? A tier 4 data center, you do not get 31 milliseconds of downtime per day. You get on the order of about 15 minutes of downtime per year, 15 minutes of downtime per year. So that's extremely reliable based on the actor model. Okay, so now you heard me tell you what an actor is. Self-contained, does one thing. You put in, you get input out. It's beginning to sound like a microservice. Does anybody here have a good definition of microservice? It's kind of like an opinion. Everybody's got a slightly different definition. Okay, so I personally don't care what your definition is or what my definition is. I now have a definition. I have the actor model as my guidelines, is what I go ahead and create as a microservice. So what I've done here is I've listed some of the characteristics of an actor, a microservice, an actor-based microservice, and I've gone ahead and, in accordance with the theme for SELF this year, I've marked those things that help you build reliable software without any bugs in them. I didn't find out that we had the little bug symbol, the no bug symbol, until after I'd already created the deck, so I just took the old no ghost from the movie. But it does one thing. You can very easily go ahead and test it. You can very easily prove that it goes ahead and does the one thing that it says that it does. You don't have to worry about race conditions. You don't have to worry about deadly embrace, anything like that, because none of these are sharing resources. They're sending messages back and forth. Resources are the responsibility of a particular actor. You can ask that actor to make changes for you. But you don't go ahead and do it yourself. Actors can be easily refactored. You don't like the way that you implemented that? Well, it's just like any type of an API. Go ahead and change the code behind it. the actor interface stays the same. You can basically use actors as bricks, and you can build any building that you want to. You can wire them together any way you want to in order to accomplish a business solution. Okay, so, and more characteristics. Yeah, there are a lot of good characteristics about actors. Actors can create new actors, so if an actor fails, another actor can replace it by creating another actor. Actor creating actor, creating actor. Well, I don't know. With cloning, maybe they will. So, okay. I like number 9 in particular. You know, the actors are small. They do one little thing. If your server, CPU, has enough cache, you could end up with your entire actor sitting inside that cache. So you get tremendous speed up with that. And then, of course, if your actors are all on different servers geographically distributed, then you've got redundancy and resiliency on a geographical basis. Actors, good stuff. Yes?
That part about sitting in the cache is how the LMDB database is so fast.
Okay, did everybody hear that? Okay, gentleman went ahead and said that the LMDB database, which is so fast, and it really is using for lookup for virtually everything, it all sits in cache, and that's how it gets its speed. Yeah. Okay, so we've got our basic building basic building block, the actor model, the microservice. Okay, we then went ahead and took a look at it and said, okay, there are really three types of bricks. There are three different patterns that we need in order to build the system that we used for India and that my company is using using as well to provide services to our customers. The three patterns were the office worker, the supply clerk, and the supervisor. And let's see, let me go through this fairly quickly here. Okay, so an office worker, you know, that's a guy who sits at his desk. He takes a piece of paper out of the inbox. He stamps it. He puts it in the outbox. Takes a piece of paper, processes it, puts it in the outbox. Or he may go ahead and take that piece of paper and say, ah, approved, this pile. Ah, rejected, this pile. Or maybe even three decisions. Ooh, East Coast. Ooh, West Coast, ooh, middle United States type of a thing. So these are the two variations on the office worker that I've got listed here. Incoming messages, the office worker processes it, whether it's a calculation or a decision, and then there's an outgoing message to the next actor level that's above it or connected to it. Okay, the second pattern was the supply clerk. Supply clerk's very important because, as I said, we don't have any shared resources. Every resource is owned by an actor. So if that's a database, actors don't change databases. Only the actor, only the supply clerk that owns that database goes ahead and makes the changes. Okay, so you got a bottleneck there. But we already know how to solve database bottlenecks by doing things like sharding, distributed hash tables, lookups, things like that. So I'm not restricting what technology you go ahead and use. I'm just restricting the paradigm under which you use it. So you go ahead and you avoid all those race conditions, all those deadly embrace. You avoid everything that was slowing down rack. Okay, and the third then is the supervisor. The supervisor is responsible for monitoring the health of all the other actors. The supervisor definitely wants to keep actors alive, wants to replace actors that are no longer working. But it also, and as I'm going to get into, we get into the next level here. Sometimes the supervisor actually wants to get rid of actors. Okay, so the second ingredient, queues. Everybody familiar with queues? Even if you didn't take computer science, someplace along the way you came across the idea of a queue. It's just a list. In particular, we're going ahead and we're using a last in, first out queue, a LIFO queue. So messages come in, they get enqueued, first message gets pulled off, dequeued. Not disqualified. Okay, so the model that we've got here is we put instead, or this is very much still like Hewitt's mailbox. You've got a queue on the front of the actor. Messages come in, they pile up, the actor goes ahead and processes them as fast as it can. Ah, this is where we disagree with Hewitt. Why dedicate one queue for each actor? Why not dedicate several actors for each queue? I've got an enrollment request, a biometric enrollment request. I can give it to one actor, or I can put it in the queue and have 10 actors. Each one, as it becomes available, pulls that request, does the work, and passes it on to the next actor. So we can basically go ahead and control the throughput of the system by the number of actors that we have pulling things out of the queue. And if we use the right technology, things like RabbitMQ or Advanced Message Queuing Protocol, ZeroMQ, I personally use ZeroMQ in India and I use it in my own company's products. You can go ahead and connect those actors to the queues such that they don't have to register. The queue doesn't know that they're there. They make requests of the queue. They're told where the queue is. And as I'm going to talk about a little bit further on here, cryptology makes sure that you're not going ahead and getting rogue actors out there that are taking advantage of their ability to connect to a queue. If they don't have the proper key, if they're not supposed to be talking to that queue, they can't decode the message that they're getting from the queue. Okay, so I said that some of the time supervisors aren't always looking out for the best interest of actors. You can determine how well your system is working based on the size of the queue. If your queue is getting larger, that means you don't have enough actors processing and you need to create more actors and attach them to that queue. And that's what the supervisor does. The supervisor looks and says, ooh, my queue's getting longer. Before things get nasty here, I should create some more actors, and they'll start reducing the size of the queue. And then, you know, where it's not looking out for the welfare of the actors, when it looks at it and says, ooh, the queue is empty, and I've got 10 actors. 9 of you, please terminate after you've completed whatever you're working on. So you can go ahead and you don't have to worry about CPU. CPU spikes real quickly. Your servers may go ahead and fall over on their side if you're trying to manage things by CPU utilization, memory utilization, any of the numbers of things that we use primarily for self-balancing systems. They can all fail too quick. They can all change too quickly for you to be able to respond to them. The queue doesn't have that problem. If you're slow, messages build up, but nothing's lost. The servers aren't going to go ahead and fall over on their side, and you just go ahead and create more actors to go ahead and take care of the work that's building up in the queue. Okay, at this point, somebody in the audience always goes ahead and says, what happens if you give a request to an actor and the actor dies? What are you going to go ahead and do? Well, that actually turns out to be fairly simple. The queue gives a request to an actor. It puts that request in another queue or another little holding bin and says, I'm going to wait for a response back. And if I don't get a response back after so many milliseconds, I'm going to put that request back up in the queue, and the next actor that wants a request, I'm going to give it to it. The absolute worst that's going to happen is I'm going to process the message twice or multiple times. But I'm not going to lose the message just because the actor died. Okay, that also has the corollary that all your messages have to be omnipotent. So you have to be able to either redo the operation without it affecting anything, or you have to do some sort of identification so that you can determine whether you've already processed that message before. Okay, cryptography. Public keys to authenticate a connection request from the actors to the queues. Hashes so that the actor can be sure that the message was really coming out of the right queue. And then encryption to go ahead and protect the actual contents of the message from the actor unless the actor's got the right decryption key. So, used to be cryptography cost us a lot of processing cycles. With the Intel NI instruction set and AMD's equivalent, at this point now, cryptography for the most part, things like AES and whatnot are one. It's no longer one clock cycle, but basically one CPU cycle. Okay. This is where Mr. Larson comes into it. Pull, don't push. Your friends told you that, or your mother told you that when you were in the playground. And of course, here's my famous, the genius, trying to push the door when in fact the solution is to go ahead and pull the door. Also, anybody here familiar with Fudd's first law of opposition? If you push something hard enough, it will fall over. Fire Sign Theater, 1971. Anybody remember Fire Sign Theater? Yay! We're all bozos on, I think We're All Bozos on This Bus was what it was from, that particular record, vinyl. That's how that comedy troupe used to distribute their material. What's that? CDs, now what is that? Was that before streaming? Oh, okay. And then I also went ahead and adapted Douglas Adams. We'll be saying a big hello to all the intelligent life forms everywhere. And to everyone else out there, the secret is, and he said bang the rocks together, I say it is, pull, don't push, guys. Lucille Ball's going to go ahead and demonstrate to us what happens if you push. She's getting enrollment requests. Okay, so the woman that came in and said speed it up, her nickname is Load Balancer. Load balancers push requests to systems. Load balancers, for the most part, don't know when systems are ready to go ahead and accept requests. They may be monitoring CPUs, they may be monitoring memory usage, but for the most part, load balancers are going ahead, or they may be doing a round robin, whatever. But for the most part, load balancers don't know what the status of the servers are. So let the servers go ahead and pull their own requests out of the queue. So, and I know there are enough of you that go ahead and listen to popular podcasts. And when somebody on the podcast mentions a website, everybody en masse goes out to that website. And within seconds, that website is serving up 500 errors. Not 404s, it couldn't find it. It's serving up 500s. It failed internally because the load balancer just pushed too much to the servers. The servers couldn't respond fast enough. They couldn't build new servers through AWS in time to go ahead and support the load. Queues don't have that problem. Pull, don't push. Okay. To recap, use the modified actor model. The three patterns, office worker, supply clerk, supervisor. If you've got another pattern, please let me know. I'm not saying saying that these are sacred and these are the only ones, but these were the ones that we needed for India. These are the ones that Formularity needs to enroll our customers. Wire them together with queues. If you use queues, you won't lose anything, and you can actually determine how well your system is processing. And finally, pull, don't push. Okay, maintaining state. Now, some of the times in the actor model, people will talk about those messages as being immutable messages, the immutable requests. We don't agree with that. We think that, in fact, the message should be mutable. The message, in fact, should hold all of the state so that the actors are stateless. The actors don't know what came before them, don't know what's coming after them, type of a thing. Everything that they need in order to process the request is part of the message. That could be large messages. That's up to you as the architect or as the developer to decide the size of the message and the throughput. But remember, if it's too slow, just add more actors. Okay. Don't store processing state in the database. That's what our middleware vendor did, and that's what got them into trouble when Oracle couldn't support it. Don't use shared memory. Again, now at that point, you've got a shared resource. You've got it all on one server. You've got multiple actors on one server that if it crashes, you're going to go ahead and lose the state. Just keep the state in the message. The message stays in the queue. If you're worried about the queue dying, create several queues. Push the message to several queues simultaneously. Tell an actor if your primary queue is no longer available, go to this queue instead. Again, the worst that's going to happen is that you're going to process the same message multiple times. It also works for networking problems where you've got the isolation, the split brain problem. You've got several actors working out of different queues. The two queues are being kept in sync until the network fails between them. Now they're each operating separately. Again, the worst that's going to happen when they reconnect is that you're going to process the same message multiple times, but you didn't lose any messages. Okay, do keep all of your state in the message. Implies that messages are not immutable. Okay. I'm going to go through this real quickly, but every real-world system, you've got your own little world, and you've built it, and you're happy with it, and then somebody says, oh, but I need input from them, and them are not going to go ahead and get the input back to you as quickly as you would like. The IRS, if you're processing like a health enrollment system, which is one of the things that Formularity is designed to go ahead and do, you need to get information from the IRS. Is the person qualified for the type of medical insurance that they are applying for, type of a thing? The IRS is really good about it. You send them requests. Every night they run a batch job. They get you all the results. They send it back to you. So you're sitting there for up to 24 hours waiting for it to come back from the IRS. You don't really want your actors just sitting around hanging around there for 24 hours. You're going to build up a lot of actors. The queues are going to get real big. So this is the case of where you can go ahead and stash it in the database. Or actually, you're not going to stash it directly. It's the supply clerk. You're going to give that request to the supply clerk. Supply clerk is going to go ahead and put it in the database. When the IRS request comes back in, or when the results come back in, you'll match it up against what's in the database. If you didn't get everything back, chances are the IRS lost something. That's an indicator to you to go ahead and send the request a second time. If you get a result back that you didn't ask for, you've got an internal problem. Now's the time for you to go ahead and start going through your logs and going through your actors and figuring out what's wrong. Okay, again, a summary. Keep information. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Keep actors small, one defined action or decision. Don't build a number of small programs that do multiple things and call that an actor. It's not. The actor does one thing. Now, you may have thousands and thousands of actors because each one's only doing one thing, but the fourth element is the solution to that. Unikernels. Anybody familiar with unikernels? Okay. I initially put this talk together and I said I'm either going to talk about the first three items or I'm going to talk about the last item, or I could talk about all four together. And what I didn't make clear was that had to be a double session, because unikernels and very light virtual machines are a whole session in and of themselves. But let me go ahead and tell you why you want to go ahead and use unikernels and light VMs to go ahead and solve your problem. Basically, unikernels are super containers. They are 1,400 times more secure than the most secure Docker container. How do we figure that? We look at how much code is inside a Docker container. You've got it, you know, you've got the kernel, you've got a good portion of the user land. We know that there's approximately one error per 100 lines of code. I've got Stephen McConnell's statistics and whatnot. And you go ahead and you look at that, and then you look at the unikernel, and the unikernel only holds those portions of the operating system that are actually used by your application or used by your actor. So 1,400 times less code, less errors. Boots 37 times faster than a Docker container. That in and of itself sells me on it. You can run, because they are smaller than Docker containers, you can run 10 times more microservices as unikernels on the physical hardware. And you can go ahead and stay within your existing management paradigms of Kubernetes or Mesos or whatever you're going ahead and using, because the lightweight virtual machines can be managed by those management tools. Okay, what is the supercontainer? It's a unikernel image running on a lightweight virtual machine. Okay, if you're interested, I would be happy to go ahead and do a birds of a feather talk on this. If anybody's interested. If not, then you know, next year I'll go ahead and submit the presentation again, however you want to go ahead and work it. So, okay, resources for you to go ahead and look up, for you to go ahead and build your own systems, for you to go ahead and believe that Brad actually knew what he was talking about, and for you to go ahead and say, you know, going back to this, Brad really didn't tell me anything I didn't already knew. I knew microservices. I hadn't really thought about pull, don't push, but it makes a lot of sense. I probably really knew it. My mother told it to me. So these are your resources. Two of them are extra starred. Let's see. That is the scaling web applications with message queues and unique, a platform for automating unikernel compilation and deployment from Ida Levine. So, but all they're good references. They're all worth your time. But those two in particular, if those are the only ones you're going to go ahead and look at, and I believe those are both YouTubes, so that you can go ahead and just watch them type of a thing. So, with that, I think we've got a couple minutes for questions. This is one of those type things where the speaker says, either I covered it so well, or nobody really understood, or maybe they don't even really care. So somebody ask a question just to make me feel good.
With ZeroMQ, how are you implementing the pull and the separate queue? You have your own layer on top of ZeroMQ that does that, or is that built into ZeroMQ now?
It's built into ZeroMQ. I believe the particular pattern that we're using is called the Pirate pattern. The book, the ZeroMQ book, by name's escaping me right now, genius, the book that he wrote, he outlined several different patterns, and we're just using the Pirate pattern directly.
There is lightning talks at 2:45, so if you want to talk about the kernel, that would be great.
It won't fit in 15 minutes. That was the problem with lightning talk.
Okay.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Thank you. I believe there's one behind you.
Could you find a way to implement a load balancer with a pull model instead of a push model?
Oh, you could. There's nothing that's really... it's secret, but there's nothing that's proprietary or something. Yes, you could. In fact, actually, I would recommend that, in fact, load balancer developers take a look at using a pull model. What you do need to do is, right now, like I say, it's all push. So when the request comes in, the load balancer determines who it's going to go ahead and give it to. If the load balancer went ahead and put it in a queue and allowed the server to pull from the queue, then you would have exactly what you're talking about, a queue-based load balancer. And I've bad-mouthed load balancers quite a bit. But as you realize, you have to push into a queue. So that's the one case where you're allowed to push. And unfortunately, the way that we've got the web set up right now, there's no easy way to input something directly into a queue. So you may need a load balancer to push requests into multiple queues and then allow your actors to take it out of those multiple queues. So you can push, but only into queues. And load balancers are bad, but not real bad.
So a little more on the load balancer for like a website?
Yeah.
So the client is going to be waiting for a large stream of information. The request is usually really small. So all the requests come in the queue. You're pulling them out, and all the data is in the message. So how does the data stream back to the original requester?
One of your actors goes ahead and returns it to that particular IP address and that particular port. There is a web server out there. Unfortunately, it's no longer maintained, but it uses 0MQ and it uses the queuing model. It's called Mongrel 2. Mongrel 1 was a Ruby web server. The developer went ahead and created a totally different model with Mongrel 2. So be sure if you're looking at it, you're looking at Mongrel 2. But basically, it takes all the requests in, puts them into a 0MQ queue. Now, you didn't call them actors, but whatever you're doing, whatever's doing the processing, then goes ahead and pulls them out of the queue, puts them into another queue, and then you've got processes that just go ahead and take that information and send it back to the same port, same IP address. The four things that define a TCP/IP return. Yes, you would have to, because like I say, there's nothing sacred about the four aspects of a TCP reply. You can go ahead and fake the port, you can fake the IP address, and then because it's TCP, you do know the correct port to go to and the correct IP address for the return.
That works for HTTPS also?
Yes, it works for HTTPS. Now we get into HTTP 3 and some of the quick technology and things like that. I can't speak to it. I'm currently not supporting HTTP 3. Well, I am, but not through a queuing model. Can answer the question?
Can you talk to the difficulty and the amount of work you put into generating your unikernels? That is a non-trivial task.
That's why I'd love to do a presentation on this, because actually the presentation includes a demo. It is easier perhaps than it used to be, and easier than you may be thinking that it is. It's basically a compilation of a C program, and you allow the compiler to go ahead and pull the necessary libraries in order to complete the unikernel. Is that getting at what you wanted to know? Okay.
Having done this work once or twice, a relatively trivial build is relatively trivial, but so is a Hello World application. So I'm just interested in how much effort your group puts into that work, and if somehow there is some mechanism you've used to shear down the actual pain.
Okay. I will agree. Okay, first of all, I agree with you on the Hello World. Unfortunately, that's my demo. but no, I agree with you on that. Maybe the Hello World's a little bit deceptive to go ahead and tell you just how easy unikernels are. If you're writing your own code, you know, you're threading. Obviously, you're not doing multi-processing, and you're aware of what your environment is, and you code accordingly. I can't tell you what all those rules are, but you code accordingly. The problem we've always faced is when you're taking existing code and trying to port it over to run in a unikernel, especially if it's multi-processing. So yes, it is difficult if you're trying to port code, if you're writing new code, which for the most part that's what we were doing over in India and what my company does, then it's less difficult, let's put it that way. And there are things like Unique from Solo IO that are making things easier. There's a commercial product called NanoVM. I'm not convinced that they're really unikernel. There's a rump kernel. There are several different things out there. It's basically finding the toolkit that works best for you. Are you in agreement on that?
Somebody's going to write something that makes it easier for them. And the question is, are you going to walk down a path that I find unacceptable?
Ah, okay. Also, remember, my actors only do one thing.
Absolutely.
That seems very
reasonable to me.
Okay.
So at the minimum, you could just take a couple things out of the kernel that you know you're not using manually, right?
You could do it that way. In fact, SE Linux... AppArmor. AppArmor restricts the system calls that you're allowed to go ahead and make, which is sort of the equivalent of stripping it out. Even the code's still there, even the possibility of some way of doing return-oriented programming to use that code, even though you're not using it, something like that. But with the unikernel and with the unikernel kits like Unique and Rump Kernel, the compiler is actually doing the stripping for you. It's only including those functions that the kernel does that your code uses.
Yeah, Java did something like that years ago. IBM did the research on it, and they would look at your code coverage, and then they would backwards assess it, and then they'd kind of like strip it down and recompile it to a smaller. So it's definitely a tool problem.
Yeah, well, for the most part, your C compiler, GCC, is only going ahead and including those portions of the C library that you're really using, those calls to the C library that you're really using. So unused code elimination is definitely part of modern compilers. I believe LVVM as well.
Right. You mentioned the worst part of like queues messing up is that you might like enqueue something twice.
Yes.
But like, there's a lot of times where like even something running at like very small differences in time could have drastically different results or something. So I feel like it's pretty easy to end up like leaning on your database too hard. Did you have like any difficulties with trying to make your application like convergent or like leaning on the database too much with that?
So you're talking about keeping the original sequence such that timing, in other words, you don't go ahead and do the withdrawal before you do the deposit. Yeah. Is that what you're talking about?
More like mutating state through the actors if they aren't convergent. Eventually.
Okay. Well, the actors hold internal state as well as the message holding state. So you can go ahead and essentially mutate the actor, if you will, by putting it into a different state. I haven't used that, so I really can't talk to it, but it is obviously part of the model, and it's not a part of the model that we disagreed with. So did I get to where you're? And as far as timing goes, because of the fact that you've got sequencing within the same queue, you're guaranteed that you've always got the right message delivery, if you will. Now, when you have multiple queues, then of course you get into concurrency problems, consensus problems, but we've got Paxos and we've got Raft to go ahead and help us with that. They're not easy, but they're out there. In fact, I saw that Facebook just went ahead and put out MySQL with Raft included. So you can now have multiple MySQL databases and keep them in consensus. Yeah. We still got a green light. Okay, well, thank you all very much. Again, I really appreciate you coming out here at 9 o'clock this morning. And enjoy SouthEast.